This month on the World Sailing Show, we meet Holland's Olympic foiling hotshots. Sustainability's on the agenda for the World Sailing Awards, and Switzerland are pushing the boundaries for parasailing in SailGP. SailGP's arrival in Plymouth was a homecoming of sorts for five-time Olympian Sir Ben Ainslie. The first time he'd raced in the UK in over 6 years, and not too far from the scene of his final Olympic triumph back in 2012.
He's really, really special. You know, this is the 10th anniversary, I think, right now of 2012 Olympics. And going back to memories of that, performing in front of a home crowd, not so far away from here in Weymouth and Portland, was very, very special. And whenever you get the opportunity to race in front of a home crowd, you know, to hear the roar of the crowd, again behind the home team, that's really special, that's really cool.
On home waters for round three, Ainslie's first goal was to make the top three final shootout and then go for his first win of the year, building on a solid beginning to 2022.
It's been an interesting start to season three. We had a second in Bermuda, a third in Chicago. Ultimately, our goal of every event is to get into that top three final sail-off. Once you're in that, of course, the goal then is to try and win it. We haven't quite achieved that in the last two events. The Australian team have sailed really, really well, come out and really nailed that final race. So for us, it's the next step is to try and get one or two steps further down the line. I'm reasonably happy with the start of the season, but for sure, work to be done.
This is the umpire. Day one off Plymouth Hoe, and it was New Zealand on top with 2 seconds and a first. But even without a hometown race win, the British fans were out in force. The speed and spectacular racing is turning SailGP into compulsive viewing.
I think SailGP has had a huge impact. I'm always seeing that in the audience figures growing exponentially as we come through season two into season three. You know, a long way to go, but the impact that it's already having is huge, and particularly impacting that younger audience, which is what we really want to reach out to. You know, both to increase the fan base for the league, but just as importantly, to inspire more youngsters into the sport.
Ainslie has always sailed on the edge, and his team hold the SailGP speed record at 94.8 kilometres per hour. But there have been some marginal moments, including a scary crash at the Sydney round last year.
The British crew have crashed, they had no rights there.
So for season three, Ben Ainslie has had to take stock.
It's been pretty hard, to be honest, because, you know, 20 plus years of racing and having a sort of using a similar approach, I guess, to risk reward. But this is a very different type of racing that we're now doing with these boats, the speeds that we're doing, the number of boats on a really tight race course. So inevitably, it requires a different approach. And for sure, we can always go faster. Someone's going to get into the triple figures pretty soon, I think. The speed is obviously really important in any racing environment, but it's going fast in the right direction is what really counts. And that's what we're all working on.
Turning up, 2, 1, up.
And unfortunately, I've got a really good coach in Rob Wilson and a great team around me, and collectively we're working it out and we're going in the right direction. Looking forward to the rest of the season.
While the goal is to catch Tom Slingsby's dominant Australian team, who won the million-dollar final races of seasons one and two, as well as the opening rounds this season, Ainslie is also proud to be promoting women in sailing. He has three women in his squad, including Rolex World Sailor of the Year, Hannah Mills.
We're really, really fortunate with our team that we have some of the best female sailors in the world, and, you know, if not the best female sailor in the world, with Hannah Mills. You know, she's the most successful female Olympic sailor of all time. We have Hannah Diamond, Nikki Boniface, who have both raced with us so far this season and done a really, really good job. What they bring to the team, I think, is a quiet assuredness. They're very good in their communications from the teams that they've sailed with before. They help us out a lot with our strategy, where we're going on the race course. And they might not appear that they say that much, but when they do say something, it's really critical information, and it really makes a big difference, a big impact on how we sail and where we put the boat on the race course.
The Great Britain SailGP team came good on day two in Plymouth with a win in race four. In the final fleet race, they just needed to stay in front of Australia on the last leg to make the final. But it was going to be tight.
And Great Britain just gets past.
This is the umpire's penalty GBR.
No!
That penalty for the Brits meant Australia and Denmark went through to the shootout with New Zealand. Ainsley could only look on from the sidelines as the Kiwis reigned supreme in the final, finally breaking the Aussie dominance.
Welcome to the show, New Zealand Sail GP. The Kiwis take the win in Plymouth.
Sail GP events are coming thick and fast, with three more European events in Denmark, France and Spain. But Ainsley also has to focus on his Ineos Britannia campaign, with the next America's Cup just 2 years away.
It is a challenge, it's very busy. I certainly think that both competitions complement each other really well. And for us to compete in both competitions really complements our team very well, be that the Sail GP GBR team or our Ineos Britannia America's Cup team. The Sail GP right now is the ultimate racing platform in sailing. But there are very different requirements in America's Cup. For example, we have side claws on the boat instead of grinders, so that's quite a big physiological change. The America's Cup is very much a technology game, and you know, having those sailing skill sets to then input into our development program for the America's Cup, very, very complementary. Also, we have great teams. We have great management teams and great support teams in both Sail GP and in the America's Cup that allows us to compete at the highest level in these two circuits.
. 2022 has been a great year so far for sailing's emerging nations. Peru's Maria Belen Buzo won IQ foiling gold at the Hempel World Cup in Holland, while the likes of Singapore's Max Meeder were putting the less traditional countries firmly on the map at the recent Youth World Championships.
You have from the highest possible level to the people who have started their run and, you know, started their training and such and just came here to experience the event, to go against and compete against the future talent as well. Because in 2 years' time, rankings might change a bit and there's new faces up at the top, and here is the place to meet them and to ride against them and to, you know, have fun with them as well.
At the same championships, a group of Ilka 6 sailors arrived pre-event for a specialist clinic to help them get ready for competition.
The aim of the Emerging Nations program is to bring all the sailors together as a group, to provide them with high-level coaching to progress their sailing both here at the event and then when they return home, to give them a fantastic experience of big fleet racing, and then to create lifelong participants who hopefully we'll see in the future at the Olympic Games, but also just carry on participating in sailing.
During the Emerging Nations program, we come a week before the event so we can try where the regatta is going to take place. It helps us to know how the sailing conditions are going to be, also create new friendships, as well as meet the coaches that are going to be with us during the regatta. And also it helps us to pump up a little more for the racing.
The Emerging Nations program has given me the best coaching I've ever had in my life. And like, it's top coaching and I've learned so much. Yeah, I feel really lucky to have gotten this opportunity.
When I'm out there, I'm just another sailor. I'm not really thinking about who's the best, because that's what the event's for. You're trying to prove you are. I'd like to think that if I can prove myself out there, that's enough. I don't have to worry about it.
It makes us feel really proud to see them out there, instilling the learnings they've taken from the clinic then into the racing, and to perform to the best of their abilities, because that's what we want these sailors to achieve, great results.
And that masterclass paid off, as Bermuda's Sebastian Kemp ended the men's event with a silver medal for his efforts. After a virtual ceremony in 2021, the Rolex World Sailor of the Year Awards are back live this year. With a closing date of the 2nd of September, nominations have just opened for one of the most important awards that will be presented at the event.
The 11th Hour Racing Sustainability Award was launched in 2018 and is now part of the World Sailing Annual Awards. And this year that will take place in Abu Dhabi in October. The award encourages entries from across all of sailing. So that goes through builders, individuals, classes, and we've seen that year on year. It's really a celebration of sustainability within the marine sector. And it's really exciting because actually it brings to life World Sailing's Agenda 2030. The award is now in its fifth year. We've had a really diverse mix of entries and winners over the last 4 years. We've had everything from yacht clubs winning, like in the first year with Corpus Christi, you know, through to regional development programs such as like the RYA. Also last year was really exciting. We had Sail Africa win, and this is an amazing project, you know, which is really pushing forward female sailing within more diverse communities within Africa, you know, which is a very much a targeted continent for us in terms of development. The sailing community has really embraced sustainability, but that's because it's kind of at the heart of everything that sailors do anyway. We're constantly seeing that evolving. Year on year, we're trying to build on the work that's being done. So, you know, eliminating single-use plastics is now seen as the bare minimum. Nominations are now open for the award on the World Sailing website. So you can fill in an entry form on there, and then those entries will go to our select panel of judges, and we'll come up with a short list, and then from there we'll generate four finalists. At that point, the four finalists go forward to a public vote, and then we will have the winner announced in Abu Dhabi at the World Sailing Awards.
The 52 Super Series arrived in Puerto Patel's Mallorca in a heat wave for round three of their 10th anniversary season. With back-to-back early season victories, Quantum Racing led the standings, but 2021 champion Sled were looking to bring the fight back to their rivals.
I think they're sailing obviously really well, but they're also quite fast, I think. I think they're the one to beat in the fleet as far as speed's concerned.
Day one. And in 9 knots of breeze, Hasso Plattner's Phoenix tacked out to the right early on, and the bold move by team tactician and Rolex World Sailor of the Year, Tom Slingsby, led to a comfortable victory to kick off the regatta. Race two, and the racing went three wide at the top mark, with Phoenix, Platoon and Quantum all fighting for third place. While Phoenix snuck through on the inside, Quantum were judged to have fouled Platoon, and penalty turns saw them slip down the fleet. Interlodge took the win, but second place for Phoenix rounded off a very good day for the South African boat.
We have changed. We've ended up changing keel fins for this regatta back to our old one. We tried a new one at the last two events, and as they say, you can't win it on day one, but you can lose it. And yeah, we're just in good shape after day one, right where we want to be.
Over the next 2 days of racing, Phoenix notched up two further victories, but Sled emerged as their major rivals, as in light wins, they won a drag race to the line in race six to pip Quantum and take the regatta lead.
Yeah, we're having a good event. Obviously, after the first two of the events of the season, we had to make some changes. Some new sails that we've worked on the designs of, and they've come through really well, and we're seeing the rewards. The boat's going really well, and Mr. Okura's doing a good job, and obviously so is the afterguard.
On day four, Phoenix were able to scramble back to the top of the pile with a second place and then a win. So with just 2 points separating Phoenix and Sled, the final day was set up nicely.
It's tight, the points, but we're in the hunt and that we're happy with that.
Strategy is just to do the best, you know, sail our own race. And of course, if we have the chance, just try to slow down our opponents.
New conditions on the final day, with a 20-knot northeasterly blowing offshore, the best wind of the week. Phoenix kept their eye firmly on Sled, jibing to cover them off when they spotted Takashi Okura's boat heading out to the left. While Provezza took the race, Phoenix scooped second, and with Sled down in eighth, they'd opened up an 8-point gap. Under pressure, Sled jumped the gun on the final start, and they were forced to recross. Their chances of the regatta victory had surely gone. Allegra enjoyed their first win in Puerto Patales, but Phoenix cruised home in second to take not only their maiden regatta title, but the lead of the overall series too.
I think we've got a real sort of self-belief in the team that even though we hadn't won an event, we knew we were close, and it just sort of fell into place this week. We sailed really well, perfect crew work, fast boat makes it easy for me to put the boat in the right places, and yeah, it all went perfectly for us.
With the Paris Olympics less than 2 years away, we're continuing our regular meet and greet with some of the sailors who'll be looking to win gold in 2024. Today, it's the turn of the foiling Nacra 17s and the Dutch pair who took gold at the Hempel World Cup in Holland.
I'm Leile van der Meer and I'm 22 years old and I'm sailing Nacra 17.
And I'm Bjarne Bauer and I'm 19 years old and I also sail Nacra 17 with Leile.
And we think this is the coolest class because it's going really fast. My role on the boat is to steer the boat and to decide which side of the course we take and make the big decisions.
And my role on the boat is trimming the boat and making the boat as fast as possible. And if Lila needs help with strategy or anything, I'm always there to add some information. She makes the final call.
If you look on the water, the Nacra 17 is the most spectacular boat to sail in because it's going really fast, way faster than the other boats. It's really cool.
I think you have a lot of aspects in our boat because it's very technical and it's foiling, so it's very chaotic. So you had a very good teamwork and keep your cool on very heated up moments, I would say.
We don't shout at each other. I think we keep our head very calm and that's one of our strengths.
I always like pushing a lot and always faster and quicker, and I think Lila's very good at keeping things safe and in control and calm, so I think at that point we fill each other up pretty well.
I think you need to be very precise with the steering, so you need to feel the boat really well. I think that's really important.
I would say you have to be brave, you need to have balls
of steel.
Of course you need to be physique strong and mentally strong as well, because it's pretty hard to handle the boat.
Time to catch up with other stories from around the world now. Hannah Mills and Ben Ainslie have announced the formation of the Athena Pathway Programme, which aims to level the playing field in high-performance foiling for female and youth sailors. The team have purchased a 26-foot catamaran called Easy to Fly, which will be used initially to fast-track female athletes into high-performance competition, including SailGP and the new Women's America's Cup. The historic Cowsweet Regatta took place in early August. The largest event of its kind in the world saw 750 boats compete in over 30 classes. It was vintage sailing on the waters of the Solent, where the overall Cowsweet title was won by the Swan 36 Scherzo of Cows. The first America's Cup boat has touched down in Barcelona, host city for the next edition of the Cup. Previously owned by Emirates Team New Zealand, the boat was the first AC75 ever to sail. Now, with a Lingi Red Bull rebrand, the boat will allow Ernesto Bertarelli's Swiss outfit to get to grips with foiling and the waters where the America's Cup will be contested in 2024. Finally, the RS Games in Weymouth saw over 1,000 competitors from 22 nations competing against each other in 14 events over 16 days of competition. Class winners at the Games included Jonathan Bailey in the Aero 5 Youth World Championships, Ollie Groves in the RS400s, and Tim Hewitson in the RS200s. Sailing's Back the Bid campaign is everywhere in the sport at the moment. The movement to get sailing reinstated into the Paralympics for LA 28 was visible once again when SailGP came to the UK. The Swiss SailGP team has partnered with the WE Foundation to promote equality across sport. Four-time Paralympian and WE Foundation CEO Bjørnar Erikstad was in Plymouth to spread the word.
The WE Foundation, we want to utilize to sports and every other aspect of the society to show that disabled people are able to do a lot of things. So we want to show that there's a lot of people with a disability who can actually be a big part of the society if the society wants. Yeah. Today we will have a super experience. We will go out sailing the F50 with the Swiss team. We have three ambassadors from the WE Foundation. We have Salum, who is the fastest man on 100 meters. And we are also so lucky to have Hannah Stodel, former British Paralympic sailor, and myself. And we will have the sixth sailor experience, and that will be awesome.
I have been on a boat before, but never sailed in my life. So I can never imagine me sailing. So for me to be here today is a lot of excitement. Very happy, thankful to be get this opportunity and just get more knowledge about what sailing is all about.
It really shows you that sailing is an inclusive sport and just how much support we have got from the sailing community when it comes to getting sailing back into the games where it deserves to be.
The Paralympians chatted to SailGP crews to find out what they were in for before heading out onto the water for a high-speed foiling session.
Today we had a good opportunity to bring out some special guests on board, some special athletes. We had some really good moments with them on board and I think they really enjoyed it. It was something quite unique for them to reach such high speed. And for us it was also very unique to be able to share this experience with them. Good fun to have Salim on board. He's obviously very quick on land. I think he's running around 40 kilometers per hour, and our goal today was to make sure we go quicker than that, and I think we achieved that. We were around 60. So now it was really inspiring to go sailing with them and give them this opportunity.
That was amazing. We had I think it's around over 30 knots. That's huge for a guy who sail at 2.4 at 4 knots. For me, it's a dream come true sailing those boats.
There's some really big names here at SailGP, and actually having them say, back the bid, they support the bid, not only putting their names to it, but also having it on their boats, on their kit, you know, it means something to them. It's not just an exercise, it is, they do genuinely support the bid to get us back in, so I think that's really cool.
That's it for now, but next month, we look ahead to the Rolex World Sailor of the Year Awards and report from the NACRA 17 and 49er World Championships.